She's a person who I admire very much for her deep love for theatre and also her personal involvement with everything that happened at the theatre. Sanjna, of course, has now moved on to Junoon. She will tell us a lot more about Junoon. From my understanding, from what Chandan has told me, it's something which has started recently, and this will bring theatre to villages, to classrooms, and it will not. Nilanjan is saying no, it will not. And Sanjna is also saying no, it will not. So I will leave this to Sanjna to be able to say more about her dream. This is something that will be more appropriate. And Chandan has entitled this in such a way that I need to read it out to you. So it's The Arts Amidst the New Growth, an Audacious Dream. Knowing Sanjna, everything about her is audacious. So
I think that's a compliment.
All right,
I'm going to sit. I can't bear this. I'm very terrified. I'll tell you the truth. I have never been to college in my life.
But I've never been there, so being here is even more scary.
I'm one of those completely illiterate human beings. So then I've prepared a paper, you see, with many, many pages and very efficiently typed on both sides. But what I'm going to talk about is really exactly that. The place of the arts in this new world of ours, where we are booming with growth, supposed growth in India. And so what is the space for arts and theatre in particular? And so then I'm going to share a little bit of me and my colleagues, our audacious dream for how we want to engage. And I'm going to pose a few thoughts, and then I want to really open this up to a discussion. So I'm not going to blabber too much. And I may come back to this, so I may wander off, and we can always, if you have something you really want to say, stop me and say it, because I like a discussion. That makes much more sense to me. And if you don't understand, am I going too fast or something, tell me to repeat what I just said. So, at the very beginning, at the very premise of anything I believe that the arts are an integral part of a healthy society. You cannot imagine, I believe I cannot imagine a healthy society or a vibrant society or without a really vibrant space for the arts. And sadly, there are not many people thinking about that. And there are not many people in India at least engaging with this thought, which is really quite terrifying. So I come from, I speak about the arts, I speak about culture, but at the core of my being is theatre. So that's really where all my learnings come from, where all my perspectives come from, is from the world of theatre, because that's what I've worked with for two decades or so. So if I talk about theatre, the theatre I've been involved with directly is, of course, urban theatre in the city of Bombay. But when I do talk about creating spaces for theatre in our lives today, I am also in particular talking about urban scenarios. I cannot speak for the village. That is really something I would be foolish to try and speak about, because it's not something I've experienced enough and can make comments on. So I talk about urban scenarios, not only huge, wonderful megapolises like Bombay, but smaller towns and cities, is also what I believe the arts need to engage with and be engaged with. So, also when I talk about theatre, the theatre I've been working with is more the parallel theatre, the theatre that is not the hardcore commercial or professional theatre. A lot of it is professional in attitude, in approach, but it's not necessarily professional because people don't live off it. Some people do, some people don't. So Prithvi Theatre has been that little oasis of a space for parallel engagement. But that's been Prithvi's work. I would rather look at theatre in a very broad framework, where there is a traditional, there is space for the classical, there is space for the contemporary, the avant-garde, and the commercial. I think that it's very, very important, especially coming from Bombay, where you have a vibrant commercial theatre. The rub-off of that in society is incredibly important and incredibly meaningful. And so I don't hold one higher than the other. I actually think this, even amateur theatre, I think they all have a very, very important and valid space in our lives and must, they must be nurtured, essentially. That's the most important thing. The most difficult task that I believe we face today is to try and articulate the value of the arts. And you should also try and think of how would you articulate the value of the arts. And if it's a performative arts, more than just a book or a painting or but really the performative arts, how would you articulate its value? And that has been the greatest burden to us when we've had wonderful sponsors and who want to understand everything in terms of an Excel sheet. How do you translate the value? And yet when they come out of a play and you know the play has churned something inside their stomach, you know it's impacted on them, and they themselves don't know how to enunciate how it impacted and what that value is. But there is a value. And we're trying to try and articulate what this transient, impermanent thing is. That is also very subjective. I may love a play, you may hate it. But still, what is this value? And I think in many fumbling ways, one has attempted to try and articulate it as in the fact that it is, actually the value is also in the fact that it is impermanent, that it is just for that moment, that it is that live engagement, that you're actually watching somebody in front of you who can forget their lines, who can make a mistake, who can also soar your emotions to such heights that it takes you by surprise. And that happens because there's a live human being in front of you doing that. And there's nothing that can replace that. And that is extraordinary. There's also something else extraordinary about theatre, is that it's a community engagement. You're all sitting in a space, in the dark, most often with strangers, and there's something you're all feeling. And there's some incredible energy that you are all emanating. And you're feeling the performance. It's not a passive engagement, it is an enormously active engagement. It's not like watching a film, or television, or the internet. It's a completely different engagement. And you see the same play tomorrow, and there's a different feel, possibly. And that is what is magical about theatre. There is, what good theatre does is it also engages your mind, and it engages your heart, and it leaves you with resonances of things to tickle your brain constantly for days and days and days and days and days after. And these are things which are important. I guess that also happens when you see a painting that suddenly stirs you, or you read a poem that does. I think the fact that something leaves a resonance is really, really important. Of course, you can see a very entertaining play, like you can see an entertaining film, and you have a great time, and you forget it the moment you walk out of the door, and that's okay. But it's not great. But how do we get to the great of things if we don't have enough of the other engagement and activity, and enough of the nurturing spaces, the catalytical processes that lead to the great? And that is what is essential. And in fact, a few years ago, I was in a panel discussion. Ramanujan was the core idea of what we were trying to. He was the base of where this discussion was going. We were trying to see what is India doing to nurture brilliance. Pretty huge. Huge question. And I'm not sure we're doing anything very concrete. I think, look, by chance, these things happen today. And I think we need to really pause and say, why don't we try and... I mean, you've got institutions like this, which is not like by chance, which may be really, really interesting in the way it's set up, but there are very few of them. And why is this not the norm? And I think these are the things we wish to try and impact and provoke and instigate. For me, the theatre is always actually very much like the circus. I love the circus all my life. And I love it because it is awe-inspiring, because it is that same thing, that moment of, is the trapeze artist going to fall? And no, of course she's not, because she's so brilliant, but she could. And they're having hands and she possibly has. But it's awe-inspiring because it is this human body that we all know, and that just does these extraordinary things. And sadly, the space for the circus in our lives today in India is dwindling, as it is for theatre completely. And I think this is what I wish to engage with, is creating this understanding why there is this dwindling space and what this new growth of our wonderful land can do to propagate more space for the theatre. So what do we have? We have our lives today where we're becoming this enormous economic machine that is growing so wonderfully, massively, supposedly. But what is this doing? What is this growth doing? What is this development doing? Hopefully a lot of good things. Hopefully our lives are improving. There is obviously education possibilities and opportunities developing. There are people earning more money. There's more possibilities of paying for things. We have basic amenities perhaps which will work more efficiently. This is what we hope, right? You hope that in a city like Bangalore you still get blackouts. Yeah? So, I mean, hopefully you shouldn't get blackouts one day. I mean, that's silly, you know, to be in this century and be this wonderful new buzzing country and have a city like Bangalore having to face blackouts. But where is there space for us to connect to who we are in this mad rush of what we're trying to achieve? And I don't believe we're doing any contemplation on this whatsoever. I don't believe we're looking at it. And I believe it's critical. It's critical. And what is terrifying is that today, urbanization is not a choice, right? We all know that. It's inevitable. It's going to happen to this mass of a country of ours. What happens in Bombay and the development there and what that city is going to turn into. I went into a corporate office some years ago, or 2 years, 3 years ago. It turned out it was Unitech. And it was quite extraordinary. I was schlepping, how many years ago? 4 or 5 years ago. And I was schlepping my bag full of my portfolios and things, trying to sell, you know, to the theater for sponsorship. And it was extraordinary. I didn't even get a chance to open my suitcase because they were selling themselves to me. I couldn't believe it. And they showed me this entire plan of Bombay City. Sat there and I almost wept. And I said, no, this is what you're going to do, my city. And what could I say? This is what they are going to do to my city. And they are going to go into slum areas and make sky rises and marginalize people living in slums and put them out in the outskirts of the city or whatever they do to them, build ghastly ghettos which are skyscrapers for them. But what is terrifying is that there is so little possibility for civil society to actually engage and say, wait a minute, can we think this through a little bit? Can we just pause and think what the impact of this is going to be to our lives, to every single one of us? And luckily, I had the good sense to say no, I didn't want the money they wanted to give us. But what I said was actually, regardless of whether you ever sponsor Prithvi or theatre, you must make art spaces in every single complex you ever build. Happen either. But I mean, it is this concern that fires me, this horrific fear that we are creating new cities of migrant people from all over the country and from all over the world now, and we're uprooting them and plonking them into these wonderful artificial spaces. We are in some such space in this neighborhood. But where is the soul of this space? What is the soul of this space? And how can we develop a soul? How do you do that? I don't know. I have no answers. But I think if we create spaces, which are spaces where you can breathe, where you can just be, where you can go read a book, or you can listen to some music, or you see a performance, and you have the arts that are accessible to you, I think that's something which is quite extraordinary. And I was reading some papers, in fact, today, because I was quite terrified of this thing I had to prepare. And there's this wonderful man that writes on culture, and he said that actually one needs to really try and he was talking about the European reality, and he was talking about how really with especially with migration in Europe, and they're facing it, and yet they have for instance a cultural practice. If you look at Europe, there's what traditional, I mean, the contemporary theatre and the proscenium type theatre is what, 600 years old or so? Is that correct? I'm not, about 600 years old. But the culture as we know it now, the cultural spaces as we know it now, were built 200 years ago. Museums, national theatres, galleries, music halls, all these great, wonderful institutions were built and developed 200 years ago by benefactors, philanthropists. But they've also stayed there somehow. They haven't managed to catch up with our lives today, or with our times today, or with our needs today. And I think that's something we need to constantly say, what is the need? So how do you look at what a need of a room like this is? I mean, you're all from all over the place. And you're all so completely different. And how would one try and I mean, you're a sociologist, so you should be clever enough to figure that one out. But how do you actually come to some understanding of what would be the cultural needs or the artistic needs of a gathering like this? I mean, I can have some, you know, ABC answers. But we need to also understand from you, and you need to find, there needs to be a possibility of you having a voice in that decision. I think that's what we need to seek in India. That it's not about me saying, this is just what I'm going to bring you, take it or else. But it's about saying, this is what we can do. These are the spaces we need. These are the kind of artists we have. This is the community we need to develop. What is it you think you want? And do you think you would like this? Would you like to go, I would love in Bombay or anywhere, I live in Delhi, to know that there was a place I could go to listen to morning rounds once a week or once a month? I can't. It's once in a blue moon when there's a special festival on, I can do that. But why? In India, when Delhi is full of musicians, why can it not be the norm? Why does it have to be a big tamasha? Oh, we have to have a stage and a mic and blah, 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 blah. Why can't it just be that I go to a garden, which there are lots of in Delhi, and we can sit down and I can listen to music? Why is it not that accessible to us? We have the art. We have 5,000 years of this wonderful culture. Why is it not accessible? And this is what our great struggle is, I think. And it's horrendous. I bring up a 9-year-old son and I have to really, you know, stream through the newspapers and figure out where it is I can take him to see things and engage with what should be easy. But it's not. So the other critical problem that the question of trying to create a, understand or articulate the value of the arts is the commodification of everything in our lives, right? Everything has to be a commodity, it has to have a price to it, it has to be purchasable. But I really, really, really do believe that there are some things that just need to be subsidized, they need to be accessible to all. Of course there's some things which you need to pay for. I believe that theatre you need to pay for. But how much is the question? And who can afford it and who can't? And why should it not be accessible across society? And I think misinformation is that a lot of people in our country believe that theatre especially and the arts are a luxury and they're only for the elite and they're only for the few of the upper crust. And I think that is just the most horrendously myopic view of India. I mean, how can you say this about India that has performance practices that range from so many different types and styles and forms in different parts of the country? And it's only because certain segments of our society in urban India just don't get access to it. And they don't seek it either. So they go to London and they'll see a play, or they go to New York and they'll see a play, but they never see a play in India. Because it's tough to also find a place to see a play. And then when and what? By the time you've heard about it, it's gone. I believe if we look at what needs to be done, I believe that we need, what we have already is a huge software. We have the artists. We do need to create training opportunities. We do, whether those training opportunities are by being an accomplice, apprentice to a very renowned organization or renowned artist, or whether it's about going to a school. There are many different ways in which you can get this training, but this is what should be made available. You need to train, you need to develop, you need to nurture the new artist, the new, also the new form, the new articulation of the art form. whatever it be, whether it's dance, or whether it's performance, or whether it's puppetry, or theatre, or writing. What we need to do is we need to develop the audiences. Now these all need concerted efforts, they need really deep, 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 deep thinking and working towards the audiences. And that's critical. The audience is most essential. Without them, there's nothing. I remember once I was at Ratan Thiam's wonderful theatre inauguration in... Were you there? Show me that.
Yes,
in Imphal. In Imphal. And there was that there was a colloquium of the finances of theatre. I was at the little babe in the woods, and there was this whole mafia, all these mafioso guys of the theatre world. It was very scary. All of them, like the dons of Indian theatre. And they were all talking about how they weren't getting money for this, and somebody wasn't getting money, and there was no money, and the government wasn't giving them money, and it was all about money. And I was doodling, and in fact, the two people that were quite extraordinary, M.K. Nainan, and I remember M.K. Nainan and Bansi Kaur, who didn't talk about themselves, but they talked about the bigger picture of the environment, and I was quite amazed at that. And then suddenly, Mr. Iyer was a secretary, Salcha, and he was sitting opposite me, and he said, but you know, I'm doing a lot for culture. I'm giving money to these theatre groups in Hyderabad, in Andhra Pradesh, and they're surviving. And I just lost it, because I come from where theatre groups perform in, right? The theatre is a platform, it's a venue that really looks at their sustainability, it really looks at audience development. It's not about just churning out dole after dole after dole. It's about how does the audience meet the performer? And I think our government doesn't really think about that much. At least it didn't used to, now it's beginning to. And I got completely outside this doodling, and I suddenly went, No, you don't have to put this on YouTube. But I just went completely hysterical. I said, no, that's what you don't need. You don't need to give any subsidy like this. You need to create spaces where the two can meet. And everybody thought, I don't know if you remember that, Shamila, but I was just completely, of course, told to shut up and behave myself, which I then did. And it took me many, 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 many years and many attempts at walking down the corridors of power in Delhi to try and understand what the schemes were, what were the policies, how was the government engaging with theatre, what did it want to achieve. And I got very little answers. I didn't get very far. And but I must say, in fact, that same time, there was a book that was finally published with all the schemes printed together. Yeah, under one cup, right? That Samarthan or whatever it was called. And Mr. Iyer gave it to me. And I was thrilled that I finally had in my hand this entire document of all the schemes that the government had. And I said, wow, can I be as audacious to ask for another one? Because then I can photocopy the other one, I can lock this up, and I can give it to everybody else in Bombay. And he said, no. Imagine how many applicants we'll get. And I just, this is what, but now things have changed. We've got the internet. So everything is out there. So it's all very fantastic. See, there is a change. The growth is happening. Technology is making our lives different. And so perhaps growth is not just this big bad word, which it could be seen as, but maybe there are other more interesting ways in which we can look at it. But I think the challenges are huge. The challenges are enormous. And for me, what scares me personally is the pace at which it's happening. It's not happening gradually. I mean, as we speak, I don't know how many cities are coming up, you know, around this country. So that is the challenge, and that is what is scary. And how is that going to impact our lives? And no matter, you might think that it won't impact you sitting in Bangalore, but it will. I believe it will. And I believe it's really, really scary if we create robotic human beings. I met the director of IMB the other day, and he was talking to me about the stress his students go through, and it's, I mean, more than possibly the stress that IIT students go through, is that what the students that try to get into IMB go through, and the disparity that they live with because they come from different walks of life, and that he felt helpless that his institution didn't offer them anything to address this huge, huge concern, which he felt was a concern. He said, if you actually speak to the students, they're in denial. They won't say that there's anything wrong. But he says, I see it. And I see it. They come out of my institute after 2 years and their parents don't recognize them anymore. And what are they going to be? And interestingly enough, in an institute like MIT, where my colleague Samira came out of, she studied mathematics in MIT and then ended up doing theater, which is just fantastic. But after the Second World War, when the bomb went off and students from MIT, professors from MIT were intrinsic to the development of the bomb, MIT actually stepped back and they said, what have we done? Who have we created? And they introduced the humanities into their system. And it is, I mean, you were talking about electives here, it is absolutely imperative that you have to, no matter what you're doing, you can be doing, you can be an astrophysicist, or you can be an engineer, or you can be doing mathematics, you have to take one of the arts as an elective, in the first as a minor and then as a major. You have to really seriously delve into the subject, not just skim the surface. In our country, we're just classic at teaching the arts as upa. It's a hobby class. But I've been to those classes, I've seen them, and they are as rigorous as if to turn out actors or directors or playwrights. Of course it's not to turn out actors and directors and playwrights. So what is it? They've obviously seen the value of it, and they've obviously thought about it, and they've obviously put it into their system. And so I went to meet the IIT directors a couple of times in Bombay to see if we can do something here, half trembling, because if he were to say yes, I wouldn't have the wherewithal to say how we managed to do it. So luckily it didn't work. But one day I hope it does. One day I hope it does. One day I hope we'll have the wherewithal. But again, it was difficult to be able to really get in and say, let's give it the space it's due, the space it needs. You need it, your students need it. They need to have that part of their brain, which part of their brain, the other part of their brain activated. And it'll make the other part work better. I mean, it's biology, you know, it's actually, somebody told me the other day, two people told me recently, very, very recently, somebody in a school, I'm pretty bad, I keep forgetting these things, where I find things out from. Somebody in a school, and I think principal, and somebody else, says that they actually get a psychiatrist letter to tell parents that their child has to do singing, or the child has to do, dance, or the child has to do drama, because parents don't believe it. They say, no, I want him to do science and mathematics and all this. And they've actually managed, and that's how they convince parents nowadays. They actually get a legal doctor, a doctor's certificate saying, this is what has to happen, and then the parents believe him. This is the crazy times we live in. I mean, I'm a parent. Parenting has changed. I can't believe the terrible things I do with my son. I mean, it's just horrendous. I'm so agitated by his homework. What rubbish. My mother never cared about my homework. And I'm okay. Yeah, I never went to college, but I'm okay. But, I mean, it's just, I can't, it's affecting all our lives. What I mean to say is, the changing times and the changing world, don't think you're immune to it. Because you're not. At least I'm not. But I don't think we are. I think it seeps into our being without us really knowing. So we have to keep pulling ourselves back to center and saying, wait a minute, what do we actually want out of all this? And that's critical. So hang on, I'm going to go back into just points and then we can have a discussion. Because I'm lecturing, this is very boring. So what I believe we need artists, right? We need to develop space for artists, we need to create that space for artists, we need to create space for audience, to build loyalty is essential. We need to create venues. Where does all this happen? It has to happen in venues. Whether that venue is a garden or whatever, it's still, we need venues. Venues of engagement, venues of nurturing. Also venues where the audience can have an oasis, they can go and have an anda. You need all that. That's part of what we're used to. That's where we're comfortable in this country at least. I think we also need something which we also forget it. We forget about and we think that's not our department. We need constant investigation into artistic validity. Whether it is research and analysis and documentation. We really need to constantly, it's not a you know, culture is not a dumb thing. It's not, yes, this is culture, now take it. You cut this piece and that piece and then you have some. It's a living, throbbing thing that evolves and moves and changes. And we need to constantly be able to address it and respond to it. And maybe even guide what can happen. But in our country, we don't think that that's important. And I think that that's actually very much part of the same thing. It's part of our concerns. So, of course, all this hopefully will impact on cultural policy, which nobody really knows. We have cultural policy in this country. Tell me that. Huh? In this document. There may be many different types of documents. Huh?
They're all secret anyway.
Right to information we can't get also, even then, okay. But, so education is critical. If we have engagement with education, we have engagement with training. Engagement with management training is critical, but we're not, it's very particular. Managers of artistic engagements are very, very particular human beings, and their processes of training are very, very particular. They can't behave like business. So we can't just say, okay, corporate business can work in the arts business. I mean, there's a living disaster, the NCPA in London. It just doesn't work. It does not work. There is a wonderful new term that I've just learned about, and I may sound very foolish because you all clever people may know about it already, but I'm going to go and find out more about it. It's the cultural animator. Now, I'm going to read this to you because it's very clever. So animation, which you all know because you're in Bangalore City, animation means literally to breathe life into something. A transformation is evolved, what was still now moves. But culture here, this is interesting, I got this off the web is so wonderful. Culture here is defined as a space for self-realization, for expression, and realization of values. A living space, which is undergoing constant transformation. So in Europe, there is a term known as cultural animators, and those who contribute to the identification, the activation, and the dynamization of particular sphere of cultural experience. At the heart of cultural animation is action. So it is an intervention, an additional action, an attitude of activity and engagement. Now, my God, wow. What if we had a training center that created these creatures? Oh, that might solve all our problems. Maybe that's a course you can start here.
There's already that.
Oh, wow. What is this? Oh, this session? I'm animating you.
So you have now animated it.
Yeah, but you are going to go out and do the work. It's grisly. Not me. I'm grisly. But I think that this is critical. So for me, what are my inspirational venues, having run a venue for 20 years? There are inspirational stories. Now, I'm not going to tell you the stories now. You can go out and find out about them. But unfortunately, we need to do research. And somebody is doing a research on the Bhulabhai Desai Auditorium, which was a space which had... Did you ever go, Shamita? Now, you can tell us about it later. But it is... I mean, that for me, seems like a dream space. It's not fair that I never saw it. It's not fair that I don't have access to a space like that. And it makes my blood boil, because why? But it was one crazy Parsi man, no, who set it up. So it was such one crazy person who said, I want to do this, and he went about and did it, and he allowed his space to be used. Then you had the Chavandas School. I'm talking about three institutions in Bombay that I'm familiar with, and that again was one organization that went in. She was teaching in the school, and she said, can I use this hall? And the big hall, which was three huge flights of stairs, old building, and you walked up all the way and you bought a ticket for 2 rupees or 5 rupees, and you saw a Marathi play or a Hindi play, and some extraordinary theatre came out of there. I mean, really cutting edge new work, which was amazing. And then they discovered that weddings needed a space, so that school decided to give that venue off to receptions of weddings and make more money. But again, it was, the space was alive and throbbing and living because of one group of individuals that breathed life into it and shared it with a whole host of people. then of course there's the Prithvi story, which is a whole separate thing as well, but that's the one story I've been closely connected to, and it is a hub, and it is a hub of engagement and adha, and maybe not an adha enough, but it is a hub of activity, and it's vibrant and living and thriving. There are three examples I just want to leave you with before we go into a discussion. There is, maybe you know about this already, something called the El Sistema in Venezuela. Again, begun by an individual. He was a musician. He always wanted to learn music. And his name was Jose Abrao. There's a wonderful YouTube piece on him in TED Talks. 35 years ago, he started this, when he just decided to take his music out to the slums. And he started training these kids. And you'll hear about it when he talks, because he talks for 20 minutes and he's beautiful. And he transformed, more than anything else, the self-esteem, not only of those individual kids, but of the entire family and that entire neighborhood. And that was pure music. That was pure classical music. Well, not only classical, they did a lot of music. And now, today, after 35 years, the San Francisco Philharmonic, the London Philharmonic, the what's it, all these Philharmonics want these kids. They want these conductors. They're not kids anymore. They want these conductors. They want these saxophonists and these drummers. They want these musicians because they have been trained with supreme discipline and they were excellent. Of course, he did it, I think, with the blessings of the government, but he did it. Then there's something which I've gone and seen called the Zip Zap Circus in Cape Town in South Africa. Again, an individual, a couple, Brent Van Rosenberg and his wife, Florence, and they're trapeze artists. They've gone and performed circus, and he came back home and decided that he wanted to create, really give back to where he came from. And his neighborhood was turning really rough. I mean, he was from a rough neighborhood in Cape Town. And he wanted to get the kids off the streets, he wanted to get them off sipping glue. And so after school, he gave them free training. And to date, they get free training in circus arts. And what they believe is, what they're really sharing is life skills. It's wonderful, thanks to Turk, right? So trust, honesty, responsibility, teamwork, discipline. And today, these performers are wanted by Circus today. I think they are the most coveted circus performers in the world, because circus has now, in the world, except for India, gained huge repute. Big money to go and see circus, because it's now not just a silly animal act thing, it's really an art. And that switch happened. Interestingly enough, that switch happened in France because of a policy. The government made a policy. They set up schools, training institutions, and they made a change. And it's incredible what comes out of those institutions now. Then there's, of course, the CESC model, the Brazilian model, which is something I need to find out more about when we're talking about it, which is community centers. These were started 60, 65 years ago. Interestingly, the Second World War happened. Brazil kept oscillating between supporting the Nazis in Germany and the US, and not sure where it wanted to go. US came in with huge industry and said, we're going to plonk our industry here. Immigrants came in from all over the world. This new society suddenly developed, and the business houses realized they needed to bind people together. So they created a system in which they pooled money together through a cess, a small tax of 1.5% on each employee's payroll. So that was all given to the government. The government then gave it out to an autonomous organization called SESC that ran these community centers all over Brazil. So Sao Paulo, which has 40 million, the state has 40 million people, it has 33 centers. And these are incredible centers which deal with the arts and sports, both, and a little bit of medicine, there's a dental service that they also have. And these are free for all the employees of all the businesses that have contributed to it. Whether it's your watchman or your CEO, the whole range, they all go free. And the public, who's not part of the community that contributes, pay. They pay, but a small amount. They don't pay lavishly. And they get to see, I don't know, but you said you went to see something which was slightly lavish, but I mean, this is what we need to investigate this and understand how this works. I think what is most critically interesting for me is how are the values, because when these two people we met recently, they came to Nina Sam where we had a seminar, and they said, to the philosophy of CESS, the human being is central. So you take the human being and what you want to do with nurturing the quality of that human being's life and what you want to contribute to that, and then you create all your programming. And so whether it's the library or whether it's certain small classes that they have, whether it's engagement with the elderly and teaching them how to work the internet, or whether it's performances, galleries, various things, and of course the sports, they enable all this, access to all of this. And I think it's a really, really interesting model. And I'll tell you, I'll read you one last thing from what the director of the Sao Paulo center, he's the big boss, Danilo Miranda, and he was supposed to come to Nina Sam, and he couldn't come because he suddenly, I'm not sure if he's already become the cultural minister in Brazil, but he says that CESC is not only a cultural or sports institution, it is a social welfare institution, which uses every possible strategy to promote the people's development and quality of life. The very base of welfare projects has to do with giving value to the human being who deserves respect within a standard of absolute equality. This is not a matter of religion or politics, it is about culture. From the cultural point of view, we are all fundamentally equal. And so the audacious dream part, I will not tell you now, but that's really what Junoon is setting out to do. But I'm not going to talk about it now like this because it sounds like I'm hard selling. So we should have a discussion and maybe it'll come up. But that's a lot of stuff. I don't know if it's led anywhere, but it's all churning in my brain, so I'm sorry about this. But it's something that fires me greatly. And I hope we can make a change and an impact on it. So ask questions. It's very bad news. It's been discussion.
Preserve what you have as your heritage too, but at the same time, I see your point about evolving and changing and responding to the needs. So how?
I shouldn't make a blanket statement like that because I don't think that that's right. But I think it's about actually opening up more spaces at the same level. So if you hold, suppose you were a city of London, okay? And you have the great British Museum and the whatever, the National Theatre and whatever else you have, and you have the Tate and whatever. But so are you also at the same time enabling more spaces of today to develop? And perhaps they are, but that's the question. It's not necessarily only about transforming, and yet they are transforming. They're constantly seeking, some of them are constantly seeking ways of getting younger audiences or accessing different audiences. And obviously also what's happening in, I mean, There was an interesting thing I read about, say, the Guggenheim Museum, right? And why are there not hundreds of Guggenheims all over the world? And the argument was that they can't be because, firstly, the man who envisioned it was unique, and that's what he envisioned. But also, the architect was unique, and that's what he created. And it's not about just replicating many such centers, but the numbers of people that go there is it justifies why they need not be anymore. But it's not about replicating necessarily, but it's about keeping alive. And in India, we are classic at letting our great monoliths become dinosaurs. I think the argument was just, it's just how alive can you make your space be and relevant to today? Not necessarily transforming it, but saying the same thing in a different language or in a different way. You have to talk differently to the younger generation, I think, I believe. And I think the ways you can do that without taking away from what it is you're saying or what is in that space. If it's a museum or if it's a performance.
I think that's it.
What do you think of the Firodia that happens in Pune? There's this Firodia festival where students from engineering colleges all over and around Pune get together and do theatre. And I think it's very vibrant.
I think Maharashtra has a strong tradition of college, either intercollegiate competitions or festivals, and I think that has fed into mainstream theatre in a very dynamic, seriously, not only Marathi theatre, Gujarati theatre, and in Bombay also. But it's changing. The quality has, of these competitions, for instance, has really, the prestige of it has also lessened, the quality has lessened. I mean, there are people like Paresh Dhawan, who's out of this system. There's younger Makarand Deshpande. I mean, there are lots of people that are out, have come, evolved from this college scenario. And I don't know, I haven't studied enough to know why it has, I think it's decreased in quality. But I don't know about that festival. I'm talking about what I see in Bombay. 15 years ago even, I would see really amazing plays. You know it's a play that's Chalu play because it's got the ingredients in to win a prize and it will win the prize. But still, it's the effort is quite amazing that's been put in. But it's really reduced in quality nowadays. So I don't know why that's happening. But it's a very essential ingredient to creating vibrancy, I believe.
So what is
Junoon? Junoon is taking all the premise of what we believe arts need to be. And it so one thing, I never use this magical word, infrastructure. Yeah? So the biggest men in this country is the lack of infrastructure. And so we're not alone. Theatre also has no infrastructure. So, Junoon wishes to address this in a tiny way by creating multiple platforms of engagement. What does that mean? We know the quality of our engagement needs to be, it needs to be welcoming, it needs to be engaging, and it needs to be accessible. So that's absolutely essential to what we do, what we create. And how do we wish to do this? We wish to work with children, we wish to work with schools, we've got a lot of programs that we're working on, with teachers. This is going to be the main focus of our engagement in the next few years. But we also want to contribute to management of venues in Bombay. We are Bombay based. So we want to contribute to management who wants to create vibrant spaces, but they don't know how, or they're stuck. And so we want to work with them very, very closely to make that happen. We also, in our ultimate goal, want to be able to create tour circuits. So we do want to take theatre across India, but not to villages, but to smaller towns and cities where theatre from urban centres at least doesn't ever go to. But we believe there's an audience. We believe there is a huge interest. And we believe that these plays need to be seen. And there's just no, it's so difficult to make it happen. So we're going to do this. We'd be mad if we thought we could do this by saying Junoon is taking you. Our attempt is to find partners in everything we do. So everything we do is in partnership with other organizations, either a partnership of using, of working with skills or with networks. And even when we go on tour, it will be in partnership. And therefore, it's also, everything we do is about capacity building and training. So even when we go on tour, finally, it needs to be that local partner has such wonderful trained people on the ground that they can manage things without us being there. Also, financially, how they can manage things. Things have to be self-contained to a certain extent. The big picture of how we're going to finance ourselves. We are looking at three avenues of income right now. Sponsorship, sadly, is one. But it must not be as much as it has been in my life, where it has been sort of 120% of my existence has been dependent on sponsorship. I never want to go there again. It's a horrible place to be, but I love oriented art. But it's too
difficult. But a little bit of what we will do, will be sponsorship worthy, because it's what they like also. Our sponsors like a little bit of finance, so we'll give them the finance. But we'll make sure we make money out of it. But we will also depend on foundations and grants. We will hugely depend on being very brave and asking people for personal donations. So you're all welcome to do it. We will have revenue streams. So our revenue streams will be whether they are workshops with children, whether they are engagements with corporates, or whether they are engagements with schools, or various types of engagements. We take what we believe is our strength, which is our network of fabulous artists, and we build programs that can be taken around and performed and create revenue streams from them. And it's about just sort of like guerrilla warfare. You know, sneak into any place, any crevice you find available, and just makes people think, wow, that's a good idea. So that's the basic endeavor.
I've seen evidence of the power of street theatre. Like an organization in Tamil Nadu, based in Chennai, which has gone around to villages trying to propagate very, very strong messages only through street theatre. They generally found that, I've gone around with them a little bit, they found that in most villages they have a common space where they have religious, where they celebrate the religious festival. So they gather around there and they're able to perform these street plays with some music which attracts children and everyone in the crowd first. So for the first half an hour, it's all music which draws a crowd, and then serious messages given about, for instance, not marrying your uncle, right? Which is a very prevalent thing there. Your mother's brother is the first one who has a right to marry you. And two, how the sex of the child is determined by the father and not the mother. Things like this, completely illiterate people have understood through theatre, and this has also been studied, and then they do a feedback check and things like that. It's enormous, the power of street theatre to get the messages across.
It's the experientialness of it. It's that you go through, the experience. It's curious how a book, you also go through the experience, no? But it's, you can put it down and walk away. But a play is different. It grabs you differently.
Yeah. I was thinking of spaces and about partnership.
Yeah. Good. Yes.
I really wanted to know what exactly we mean when we talk. If you go to my school, ask me one music period and one drawing period. So that is what art. So they probably say that we have art in our school. Secondly, I want to know, like in the urban area, the people come from villages. Like if I come from a village of Rajasthan, I have my own culture. Like, I like seeing maybe a Bengal festival in which people dance, putting a doll on their head. Or maybe some other kind of like here is a very common example in Rajasthan. Then coming to slum area and somebody will come and say that don a guitar, an organization will come and say that we want to develop this art value in this. So come we make you a guitar or let's do it here. It's not wrong, it's a nice idea. I'm not really sure that what kind of spaces we are creating and the way in which we are
creating. Yeah, but you know that guitar player kid may get a job in a movie, like orchestra or whatever. You know, then you will be the next big huge pop star. It's a very tricky one, that question. What we want to try and do away with is the frivolity of the arts class and the music class in school. That is ridiculous. If it can be given as much rigor and seriousness as our maths classes get, or our science classes get, or physics or chemistry, that is what one seeks. How one does that? An institute like this should be an answer. You have to educate the educators, huh? And that is the most important thing. So, there are two questions in what you asked. So, for instance, what we want to do with school teachers is we don't do theatre in education. That's a very specific form of education. But really, what we want to offer them are just pure theatre workshops, really intense, rigorous theatre workshops that a theatre person would undergo as an actor or a writer or a director. And we believe that that experience will leave something with the teacher. And we've seen it in what we've done in the past. Strangely, it does odd things. I mean, we had one workshop 2 years ago and we asked the principal what happened. Was there some effect in your teacher's participation? She said, you know, it was remarkable. One of the participants, her crowd management just seemed was better. But depending on class trip, she's just really, really organized. Of course, it was a theater and maths workshop, so it's a particular kind of workshop. But even if it doesn't reflect in any concrete way in the classroom, I think what it will do will be it will energize teachers, and that is essential. But coming back to one, that's what I think one has to ask for. That community wants also. How can I presume I know what somebody living in Dharavi wants? I wouldn't dare go there. I have no clue. But if I find a partnership with some organization that really knows, and I trust them, and then there's a conversation that can happen, and there's resonances with, okay, I find that it's a way that my skills and my network, I'm not saying I can reach every single part of, you know, Bombay. But maybe there is something that can be worked out that works. But maybe not. And you know, Suresh Anbag recently had an experience that he shared with us where he took all his place to some rural, semi-rural center and there was a group of people that were going to be, union leaders, a union organization that were going to come and see it. He was ready to perform in their field, so, and they, you know, he said, so where do you want to see the show? And they said, I want to go to the Ocean Auditorium. We want to see it in our field. We're in our field all the time. And so we can't be presumptuous. We don't know what people's aspirations are. Now, that is the other thing. What are people's aspirations? That's the other scary thing. What is the exposure we're giving people to enable them to have a wide range of choices of aspirations? I find our lives are getting narrower and narrower and narrower. Disneyland is like our one and only aspiration. And then what do you do? So how do you broaden that? And you have to be, that's what, it's exposure, it's accessibility. It's about saying there is an alternative. So, I have not answered you really, but I would think 100 times before going to Dharavi. But I would go to a public space nearby. I would go to a public space nearby and hope that I could attract the people that live in Dharavi and the people that live in the skyscraper to come and see a play. For me, that I would love to do that. And we've done it to a certain extent. We presented shows for 10 years in a garden in South Bombay, very fancy, for Delia. But we literally had people off the street. What is the... There's a politically correct word for this. Anyway, we'll get a story later. There's a story I have to tell you, but I'll tell you later. I just got a politically correct word to use. Transsexual. There was a transsexual sitting next to a CEO with a suit and a tie and watching a play. And the transsexual was a beggar transsexual. Not that they were transsexuals, but they were beggar. And that was just amazing.
Now that happens. So then they love, they laughed and cried at the same thing.
Out of curiosity, I might be going a little off tangent, but why theatre? Why did you choose theatre when you could have more easily, you know, taken films?
Yeah, Kwasar Parasi is very upset that I stopped being a film actor because he said I could have funded lots of theatre. But he's presuming I would be successful. I don't think so. People forget I had both grandparents who did theatre. So I grew up listening to theatre stories. My British grandfather was my all-time hero, and he lived a life of theatre. It was his life, it wasn't a production. And he travelled this country which he adored, and he performed for his most favourite audience in the world was the Indian school girl. He said they were just enraptured listening to Shakespeare. Those stories I grew up with. Unfortunately or unfortunately, my parents exposed me to world cinema. So, yeah, it was very alien to me. Thank you. What would you want to see in your life in terms of, is there anything missing in terms of arts? And I mean, so whether it's a museum or whether it's a gallery or whether it's a film space or whether it's a... Is there anything missing? Or do you get... Are you happy? Or you think it's really boring? Which is awesome.
It's probably all of that. In the sense that I have two children. Having the city itself accessible to people.
Every neighborhood, every ward, something.
And then there are places you go that are sort of actively encouraged and trying to be very quiet. So I would rather see where there is space. And it can be just a public park where you have three abstract structures. Then you go to one abstract structure, try to go and look at that. Ask questions of what is this, why is this here. It's a space to think about.
So why do you think it's not there?
I think partly we've sort of sold our soul to the need for growth. And land is just...
Even the parks are there.
No, half of the parks are... See, it needs to belong to a community as well. And
something nobody
can
do. Engagement is something that's very close to my heart, and
it's shocking. A perfectly decent play is ruined because they bring some music into it. And the words are different, but the tunes, and immediately the audience loves it. So the group piece is great. So when I say it's a load of rubbish, they think the audience loves it. So if there are people like you that don't like it, you need to let it be known. Please. Teach your child to take off their shoe and throw it at the action. Violence, I don't subscribe to, but it's a good
I mean, you published theatre first, and what you gave just now was in the lecture for the performance, and it was great.
Just listening to that. I'm an administrator, I'm so worried.
But I'm starting to believe that we have a performing artist within ourselves, and I think it's so important for us to
sound creativity or something somewhere always, and we don't have enough opportunity. My husband came home yesterday from my son's orientation. Today is his first day in school, and I'm here. Can you imagine how traumatized I am? He said, Mama, how am I going to get through my first day of school in this new class? And my husband had a good orientation, and he came back a little confused. He wasn't sure whether he was proud or anxious that he was given a piece of paper and he had to answer the four questions. I didn't know. He had to answer the four questions by drawing a picture. So, and he had to put it on a board. So, I think that's the most creativity he's got in the last 50 years. But, we just don't have enough opportunities to be creative. That's
identity,
and what say again?
Identity.
And identity, right? So So how to address empathy and identity if you're working especially with school teachers or school kids, right? That's, I think, how you design your workshop is very important. It's most critical. And diversity, I think, the fact that especially in these new cities, I mean, that's going to be developed, the fact that we need Bombay. The fact that Bombay used to be a fantastic, we got to celebrate the cosmopolitan nature of it. And I believe after 93 that got shaken up and nobody addressed it and nobody was concerned with it. And the cosmopolitan age is gone. It's compared to Delhi, it's not gone. But it's not there. It's not the same thing. People are ghettoized, they're living their own lives, and it's not celebrating the fact that we have so much diversity, so many languages. So in a city like Bombay, for instance, my answer would be create public arts engagements. Put up poems in the bloody local trades in different languages. Celebrate different texts, especially when what's his name was going around making everything Devanagari. Not even Devanagari, Marathi. But I think that the artist community didn't do anything. So we have to break also. We don't go out and reclaim our spaces. You know, if you do have the power, if you do have, and you want to say, but this is mine, it's going to be mine, I'm going to engage with it, I'm going to do things there. Even if I'm going to sit with my kids and just paint a painting or whatever, I don't know. And so that's the big public arena. And how one engages it with, you know, small workshop scenario and a training scenario, those are, I can't really go into the detail of those processes here, but that's how you design.
Because if they had more venues to perform in,
they could then sustain an earl of wine. So I hope, I hope the scenario changes fast. I hope we do keep them, we don't lose them to banking or the corporate world or something else. Or television, which is yours.
Again, can I say, it's for Ali. So often seen as stated, like, only theater should be urban people can afford to be able to do theater. And the other form is Junoon Theatre, which is basically for the like, rural sector. So even if the middle class is using the theater,
the low middle class.
Because in movies, like, everyone can afford too much movies. Irrespective if it's from ethnic class or from rural sector.
You know how expensive movies are becoming nowadays?
Movies are going, but the customer, like, but to the viewer part, it's not.
One video going to the cinema today.
There are small cinemas also. You can't afford for the figures and you can't do for small cinemas.
Yeah, but you know, luckily our audiences, they want to see it but bada parde par dekhna hai. Iska maza kuch aur hi hai. So I look, they take that. There again, I would say that I wish the government policy looked at that problem. I wish it looked at that. Ironically, in Mumbai, there is a Bihari community that once a year on one of their festivals, they have a maidan that they book, and about 5,000 or 3,000 of them come, and they have their traditional.
Social sanction. That was a part of the sad story about theatre also. If we wanted to do theatre, we were not allowed because you had to practice at night.
Interestingly, Marathi is
still living.
But still quite recently, if you said you do theatre, people say, ah, what? You said you did Marathi film, but I asked them. The status of Ulta in Marathi.
Yeah.
Because still you regard it with some respect in Marathi theatre because it is incredibly important part of Marathi culture. I mean, where in the world do you have a play release? At the play, you can buy the play script, you buy it, you read it, you go back and see the play again. I mean, it doesn't happen anymore. It used to happen until 8-9 years ago. See, it's phenomenal.
So, in this manner of seeking funds from various sources, and this manner of reaching out, what are the gains that you see for theatre projects? And what are the concomitant associate losses or compromises that might happen? You know, I'm sure there's something to be gained in terms of political thematics, cultural questions that come to spaces that have kept them out. It just becomes the attraction of dynamic that you want to put in that country. Or did you wish for this venture to make happen? In addition to this, achieving this larger gain of taking arts everywhere, the political gain, the political losses, I mean, to the extent that you can foresee them at all.
I think that we're just, you know, she knows she's going to be, we're just very stubborn people. So we will keep to the core of what we value. And we're not going to cater to what the money bags may want us to do. So I don't see, I see us being practical. I see us having a certain amount of savvy, because that's stupid. We can't survive as much money as film or television or anything else. So we all settle for that. We do believe you can. We do believe that we want to address this question of why can you not live off theatre, and that is essential. And so one has to be incredibly entrepreneurial and innovative. And it's an adventure. But it's, I don't know, I mean, if dancing in a bar is banned, if suddenly theatre in schools is banned, you know, what can we do? Dancing in a bar is banned? Something is banned, maybe.
Or not.
Okay. So, I mean, who knows? Tomorrow maybe that'll happen. Maybe you can't do theatre in schools. Maybe it's banned because what the content of what we're talking about is unacceptable. What do we do? You know, I mean, then we go and farm. It's just that I think that there's enough out there for people to do. And I think what keeps. There is a big feature, we are varying society. We are not cultural society in another model. So then you have your values. You believe, I've been asked to actually engage with a huge project in Gujarat, to actually create and to put all my dreams and aspirations into practice. And I was told that if you succeed here, this will be the model for India and everybody will emulate it. But whose logic was it? And there's no question. I mean, I wasn't going to do that. I can't live with myself if I'm going to work with that man. So that there's no two ways around.
This will be second most important. It wasn't as important as the first one. Okay. So what does it mean to bring Marathi theatre to a town in Karnataka? And vice versa, you know, Kannada theatre to Bombay. And how can you see this enriching the Indian theatre experience and extend that?
You know, it all has to be within context. I mean, it doesn't work otherwise. So we've done it. I've done our theatre festivals. I've had theatre from all over India come to Bombay, or we travel our festivals as well. We brought our festivals to Bangalore. But I wouldn't just do it for the sake of doing it. It has to be within context. It has to be somewhere. I always ask myself the question of, is this really valid? Am I forcing a culture? When I program a festival, for instance,
Am I forcing an agenda now here? Am I forcing what I think is true? Firstly, do I think this is right? I mean, that has to be, it has to be, it can't be, this is right because it's going to bring the money in. I can't work like that. I don't work like that. So, I'm very stupid. I've lost a lot of opportunities that way, but I can't. But does it feel right? Do I want to see this? Yes, that's always been my impetus. That's always been my motivator. But then, there's always this, there's a fear of saying, does somebody really want to see this terribly obscure Polish play on stilts? You know, does it make any difference to anybody? And it's amazing that, that 17 years later people are stopping me on the road saying, my God, that show was mind-blowing. You know, and but I believe that in any art, whether you're a painter, whether you're a poet, whether you do abstract work, whatever, if it is true to you, it will resonate with somebody else out there. But if you have a, if you are catering to them, you're screwed. But that's I think, I'm not sure about answering this.
Later.
You're not going.
I can catch you on video later.
But I, that's very funny. Okay. So what do we want to do right now, the very first steps? Firstly, we've got something called Arts, my organization.
Yeah.
We've got something called Arts at Play, which is starting this weekend in Bombay, and it's a 22-year-old program.
Arts at
Play. Go to our website. Oh, tell them to go to our website. It's a very nice website. It's called JunoonTheatre.org. Please tell everybody who was involved. I'm very proud.
Junoon?
Junoon Theatre.
Spelled
English way, .org. And so everything is there. Basically what we do is we do these workshops for children. We've got 45 workshops across 5 centers, short 15 to 20 hour workshops. And then there are also seasonal plays that are produced by professionals for children, not with children. The workshops are process oriented. They're not result oriented. So they're not about doing a play or presenting for parents, or our parents have now understood that they're not going to see anything. And if their kids are sweet, they will tell them. But if they're like mine, they won't tell them anything. But it's what the kid goes through. And that is critical. So what we're doing with schools is we are offering them treatments. We are saying that we are going to program. We want you to take your children to the theatre once a year, if not more. And we will come to a theatre near you, in your neighbourhood, and a professional, technically equipped theatre, maybe. And we will then have a show for your children, out of these shows that, we, that we're presenting now. So that's from Bombay groups. But we give the kids a little pack that goes back with them, dealing with the theme of the play. So it's like a delicious little thing they take home, and they can... It provokes them to engage more, to explore, to find out, to go into something, the library or the web or whatever. It sort of gets them deeper into the play. And they can talk to the actors after the show, they can have interaction. Things you can't usually do when you go to see a play and buy tickets, it's a little bit special. The engagement with schools will also be, we offer the school teachers a workshop that we offer. And we are producing, the only thing we're producing right now is a module, we're calling it, for the lack of anything else right now, we're calling it Encounters. And we are going to the professionals we know, whether they are a kathak dancer, or a playwright, or an actor, or a musician, or a puppeteer, and they are making a 1.5 hour module, 45 minutes, with interactive. It's being in an audience, and it, so it can be in a theatre, it can be in a hall like this, it can be in a large home if you need anything, interactive with you, so you get to understand the skill. When it's a poet, you know, just engage with the skill of that poet, of poetry. When it's a puppeteer, you actually get up and do stuff with your hands. You get to see things you ordinarily would not get to see, and experience and do, and then you go and have an interval, you come back, and there's a performance. And the performance needs to have a little bit of that wow quality to it, otherwise it's disastrous. So it has to, and it has to just, it's a short, impactful performance, and that's what we're taking the schools. because we know that it's through experience that, and it has to be a professional experience. You know, it has to be that that engagement with the professional. But, and so we offer it every year or every term to the school. I mean, they can have one coming every 3 months. And we're happy. We would love to come to Bangalore. Right now, Bombay is our pilot. So I think we'll come to Bangalore in 2-3 years now. Not yet. But perhaps. But actually, we're offering this to corporates also. And if they were making money for it. And they're interested. They're actually very interested. It's become the sort of dumb thing to have a version. Okay, make a slog. That's the delight, we have to get this slog. I did one something silly once, so they really refused to come. In your coffee shop or coffee break or something, you guys make puppets towards the silly things. So I made them do really silly things. It was very fun. But it actually sends, I think another thing when we're talking about value, I think in our head, the theatre community, our garibi is in our brain. It's our own garibi. We don't value ourselves. And then we deserve to be with. So unless we just make that switch, nothing. Why should it be outside of us? And it's not about saying, oh, I'm so great, I'm an artist. That's not what we want to say. But it's saying I matter. What I'm doing is very serious. And what I am going to put into what I'm doing is rigorous. Now, I have to get there. Some people, not enough. So you should have a theater workshop here. You should tell your management that you want to move, come and create a workshop with you today.
I'm not the management.
We'll do one with the faculty and we'll do one with the students.